Bethel World Outreach Church. Reaching a city to touch the world.
Well, I'm really envious of Pastor James. He is in Selma today. So I just got off the phone with him. I said, I miss one of my little dreams was to walk across that bridge with him. We'll have to go down and do it together when nobody's watching. But what a great scene it was yesterday to see President Obama and President Bush leading a throng of people across that bridge. You know, there is a power beyond politics. That's the only power that's going to unite us, something that's greater than all of our systems and political ideologies. And just to see that power, I believe that power is at work in our country. At times it seems it's, you know, where are you, Lord? But I think there are glimpses of God's grace that we see. So anyway, welcome to our online audience. We have a growing online audience, so welcome to you in the upper venue. Welcome. Wave at me in the upper venue. See, that's where I'd probably go to church, is up there. I could get some coffee and sit in the back. Wouldn't worry about spilling it. See, you're smart up there. It's all good to see you guys. We're talking about discipleship. You can see the banners behind us. Whenever we talk about discipleship, I kind of feel like the airline, steward, trying to tell you about the seatbelt. As soon as you hear that speech, you go, oh no, here we go. And it's that one speech we think we can tune out, but still understand what that is. But Jesus, his words to us, go into all the world and make disciples. And so making disciples is not a Bethel program. It's not a, boy, isn't that a clever gimmick. It really is the very thing we signed up for. Disciple just meaning basically a learner or a follower of Christ. And so the reason you're here today is because somebody helped you. No one got here alone. Not just your natural family, but someone spiritually made an impact on you. And so the simplicity of that, in fact, if I kind of deconstructed or just listened to every one of your stories, it would be just a sea of diversity in terms of the little things that were said, or the words of the kindness, or the somebody that cared enough to look up from their busyness and to engage you in a conversation. And the fact that somebody probably just wanted to talk to you or pray for you may have just kind of jolted you. I don't know, but maybe these are good times to think to yourself and maybe even write out a little in a journal or something to say, you know, what really happened? What was the thing that happened to me? And then ask yourself the question, you know, what, Lord, what am I doing to fulfill your command? And show me, must be easy, because the Bible says his commands are not burdensome. You know, whenever I'm trying to get something to work, I don't understand, and I start tearing stuff open and mashing it, I'm thinking, you know, whoever created this thing knew it was going to be, made it easier to get into it than I'm probably understanding. So there's got to be a better way. You know, there's got to be an easier way. I just don't know. And I think that's our job, is to help come to greater clarity and simplicity, so it doesn't seem like some big mountain you have to climb over. It's some huge, impossible thing. Had a foreign student, a Chinese student, came to one of our events years ago, and we had a big cheese ball in the very front, you know, like y'all, the little snack table. And there was a giant cheese ball, and the cheese ball was missing. And all of a sudden, 15 or 20 minutes later, this Chinese student, like been in the country a week, came back with the whole cheese ball. He said, "Too big, cannot finish." I said, "No, you don't have to eat the whole thing." You know, I mean, sometimes we present like, if you're going to really follow Jesus, you got to do some impossible thing. No, you don't have to eat this whole thing. So, and I want to make sure that we're clear about that. I think that if you look at the numbers, if you look at the data of our country, I kind of explain it as a spectrum. On one end of the spectrum, let's say over here, you've got the skeptics, the committed atheist. And that's a group of probably between atheist and agnostic in America, about 6%. About 3% atheist, about half and half, but there's only about 3% that are just, we are atheists, we reject God. And then there's the agnostics that say, we just don't want to say we're atheists because that has a lot of connotations. that we don't want to carry. So we'll just say we're agnostics, like, hey, but that agnosticism is not a we don't know. That's a very much an intellectual agnosticism of you can't know. It's a big difference in saying I don't know and I'm searching versus I don't know and you can't know either. Okay? It's a long story, but anyway, just trust me on that one. So that's 6%. If you go to the other side of the spectrum and you say, how many Christians are there that really can articulate their faith, explain it to someone else, and give them not just basic little glib answers, little cliches and, you know, let go and let God, or, you know, just trust God, brother. No, you get beyond that. Can you really answer people's questions? That might be 6 to 8%. Now, that doesn't mean that people that are call themselves Christians can't maybe tell you the gospel or explain, but in terms of the ability to articulate and answer the questions people are asking, that's not a very big number. And I've broken that down because you go church by church and you start analyzing churches and you realize how small a percentage of churches are growing through evangelism, and then you trace that back to say, well, it's because a small group of people even understand how to articulate their faith or have any confidence to engage other people with these questions. And so here's the battle. You've got both ends of the spectrum are pushing, at least they should be. Now, this end of the spectrum is really committed. They are as committed to their unbelief as that other group is committed to evangelizing. Now, the difference is there's a growing number called the nuns. Now, this isn't a religious order, a Catholic order. The nuns represent, that's N-O-N-E-S. That are the people that say, none of the above. I don't want any religion. And that's, in other words, this group of 6% that's pushing, that group of nuns are increasing. And even though, now it's 14%. So the 14% of Americans will say none. No religion, not non-denominational. No, none. Like, don't even talk to me about it. And one third of that are young people. And that's growing, doubling. So if you look and say, is this group on this end pushing as hard as that group over there? And you can kind of see at this point that this side of the spectrum is growing. And you're getting more and more people saying, I'm willing to kind of drop my faith, kind of like an outdated cell phone. I'll forget it. And the vast majority of Americans over here that really would say, yes, I'm religious, I'm a Christian, you know, it's a personal thing. It's so personal, I haven't even discussed it with myself yet. That group. So what I'm trying to do and what we're trying to do is to equip this kind of soft middle to be able to become like this, so that you can be able to articulate and answer questions that people ask and be confident in it. It's not really too much to ask. I think that in every believer's journey, I would want to be able to not default to I don't know all the time for everything. Now, I say I don't know a lot, but I'm saying it less, because if I don't know something, that bothers me. If you have a sincere question that's keeping you from God, I want to pay the price to learn that so that I can come back to you. Many times I've done that. I said, look, that's a great question. I don't know the answer, but I'm going to find out. I'm going to come talk to you about it. And so if we're engaged with people, so making disciples is about realizing that if we don't do something, then the consequence, the consequence of this spectrum I just painted will not be felt maybe even in your lifetime. I'll tell you where it will be felt. It's going to be felt not even in your children, but in their children. And your children's children, they're going to wake up one day and you're going to say, what happened to our country? Last Sunday, I was in Marseille, France, and we have a church plant there in Marseille. It's on the coast, and flew into Paris from Turkey. We'll talk about Turkey in a minute, but because that's another story. But looking at the cradle of where, you know, you think about John Calvin, you think about all the things that happened, the Huguenots, or Huguenots, as we say, in Tennessee. But looking to see how little engagement, or to see what used to be a place where maybe people understood God, but now it's just a desolate wasteland. Turkey, the same way. If you opened up your Bible to the book of Maps, to the very back, all the maps that we don't even use in the Bible, and you look at Paul's missionary journeys, that was Turkey. Okay? Ephesus, the book of Ephesians, that was Turkey. Colossians, Turkey. Every church, the seven churches mentioned in Revelation, all from Turkey. Sardis, Smyrna, all of that. Laodicea, gone. Colossae doesn't even exist. The city doesn't even exist anymore. But Jesus basically said in Revelation, he says, if you guys don't repent, I'm coming and I'm going to remove your lampstand. That's the light. Basically what he's saying is, if y'all don't get straight, I'm going to just come turn the lights out personally. And when God turns the lights out, lights are turned out. It's dark. And now in Turkey, it's 99.6% non-Christian. But there we've got a young church planner there in Istanbul. And very proud of him. So never has there been a more urgent need for us as believers to learn not only how to articulate our faith, but how to make disciples. What does that mean? It just means basically we're going to learn how to help other people follow Jesus. And that's a beautiful process. I was so proud of our, there in Marseille, France, the churches, if you got 200 people, it's huge. But to see our guy there, he's learned the language. He was a baseball player at University of Houston, went on a mission trip to Budapest. If you don't know about that, it's a city that's on one side is Buda of the Danube, the other side is Pest. I've sat there and kind of drinking my coffee, looking over to the Buda side from Pest. I went from there to Austria, and now he's learned the language fluently. He's got the ability to plant churches across France. I mean, God is going to move in France. We had a great meeting there. Two Muslims came to Christ in the last week. I had a Muslim physicist approach me after I talked and just said, this is blowing my mind. He said, I'm just starting all over from ground zero because now you're giving me something to think about. And I think that we can all be in a place that whoever your world is and whoever is around you in your world, you can learn to engage them. So here's the question I'm going to try to answer. I'm going to try to answer the question and repeat this because you've heard this. When you say, how do you make a disciple, what does that mean? If I ask you, how do you make a cake or how do you make gumbo or what's your, how do you make your favorite dish? You could probably write out the recipe of how you make that. Now, when we say, how do you make a disciple in this church and around the world in our movement, we like to use this thing called the four E's. In fact, I'm thinking, Pastor Bruce and Carol, we need to get a singing group, not the four tops, but the four E's. We need to have us a little group, a little shuffle going on, do whatever we can do. But the four E's are the first one is engage, then establish, then equip, and then empower. Engage, establish, equip, empower, engage. I did, by the power of technology, I spoke yesterday to 10,000 life group leaders in Manila. Our church in Manila has 10,000 life group leaders. That means, the church is really, really big in Manila if you have 10,000 life group leaders. And you can go on Twitter and do hashtag discipleship 2015, and you can see the pictures and telling the story of this. But I was able to talk to them from here at from Bethel to those life group leaders without having to fly all the way over there. But they are growing because they are systematically teaching that process. And what I came to do yesterday was to talk more in more detail about what does it really mean to engage? What does engage mean? We're talking about engaging lost people. And so I want to just talk just in a brief overview today about that process. But engaging starts with God. It starts with our commitment to engage heaven. This isn't just about a human enterprise of going out trying to talk people into something. If you look at the New Testament, Jesus was sending his disciples out to go, but he said, before you go, I want you to wait and be clothed with power. So the very first thing before this worldwide mission began was Jesus saying, go and pray and wait. Now, when I watch Jesus in the Bible and I'm thinking, well, here is the Son of God, why did he pray so much? I mean, if you had that much power and that much wisdom and that much going on, being God incarnate, you wouldn't spend but a little bit of time kind of doing an obligatory, quick prayer like you do before your food at a lunch with a business associate and boom, you're off to, just to go in what you're made of. You got it going on. But Jesus spent hours and days and weeks in prayer. And then when he came out from that There was something different. When I asked my son this morning, when we were talking this morning, I said, if I ask you what image of Bethel, if you had one image of Bethel that kind of was the iconic representation, what would it be? And my 15-year-old goes, Pastor James praising God. I said, okay, that's a good one. I said, but we talked about the hands and about this picture. And even though to many people these represent diversity, really the first image that it's supposed to communicate is prayer. That we are a people that believe that if we pray, that something's going to happen. I don't understand why God makes us pray. I remember thinking that, it's like, well, gosh, well, you've given us all this stuff to do. But the image that keeps coming back to me is like a wrestling match. I remember growing up, wrestling was very, very the big deal. I should call it not wrestling, but wrestling. My grandmother, I remember getting saved, and my grandmother had arthritis, and I said, her name was Mama Kern. I said, Mama Kern, I'm going to pray that God heal you. She goes, no, I don't believe in that. I said, Mama Kern, you believe wrestling's real. You know, how can you not believe in prayer, you know? And anyway, but in wrestling, you'd see the tag team match where one guy would be fighting, and then he'd almost be, look like he was going to get pinned, and he'd reach out, and he'd touch his partner. And every time I see that painting of God reaching down and the fingers of God and man touching, I see it like that wrestling match. That if I can just touch my tag team partner, you know, God could have created a world that was total control, where he controlled it all, that we would be oblivious to any conflict or any need, because we would just be like, fish in a fishbowl, not having any awareness of need. So he could have created a world with total control on his part. Or he could have created a world of chaos where he was completely detached, nowhere to be found. But he created a world where there's real interaction between us. We have real choices, and he can intervene, but he's somehow chosen to create a world that when he intervenes, for the most part, it's when we ask, when we reach out to him. So if Jesus prayed and reached out, then I'm going to do it. You're going to do it. So it's simply just praying and asking, not just for neighbors, but ultimately for nations. You could start out just saying, Lord, help me. That guy across the street, I keep running into him. Lord, I'm asking. At some moment, please open the door. You'll be amazed when that prayer gets offered how those doors will open. It opens doors for neighbors. It opens doors for nations. When I was walking around Turkey with Fikri at my side last 10 days, glad Fikri with his had my Arabic radar going. They speak Turkish there, but obviously the Arabic, big Arabic population too. But I remember years ago, we had an old prayer warrior named Verlin Ming that was here. Anybody remember Brother Verlin? Because of Verlin, we had to stop singing the song, As the Deer Pants for the Water. He's a deer hunter. Every time we'd sing, I said, no, Verlin, we're not. Just the thought of mentioning the deer, he just got alert like that, you know. But he came down praying one time. He got down to the microphone. This is Verlin's prayer. He came down kind of like a John Wayne, kind of walking down like this. He grabbed a microphone. Lord, you put on my heart the nation of Turkey. Here was his prayer. Lord, you put on my heart the nation of Turkey. Lord, what kind of name is that for a country? I don't know. Will I pray for Turkey? That was his prayer. Lord, what kind of name is that for a country? Believe me, when I was walking around Turkey, I was thinking, God heard that prayer. Tremendous church planter there. We'll be in, Lord willing, we'll be in Norway. Carol, talking real spiritual to you. Sister Carol, Brother Bruce. Sister Carol has been meeting with the Sons of Norway, is that it? And having these groups of people come together. So there's a good chance we'll be in Oslo. Been thinking about Iceland, not just because I fly over it a lot, but there are nations that God's going to put on your heart. And as we pray for those nations and we ask, God, open the door. God, I'm asking you. So when we're going to engage, we engage God, number one. And then we go out and we engage others. We have this little tool called the God test. And these things we give out more than I don't think anybody would buy, but they're all different kinds of languages. But the essence of this is a tool to help you remember this simple process of engagement, and it's called SALT. You start a conversation, you ask questions, you listen, and then you tell the story. Then you tell the gospel, and then you tell your story. So again, we're trying our best to make things clear. SALT, can I remember that? Start a conversation, ask questions, listen, tell the story. Whether you have this tool in your hand, which gives you questions to ask, or whether it's just a process of engagement. Most evangelism and engagement to others is we feel like we've got to give this speech, kind of like a telemarketer. We're going to get a hold of somebody, and we've got about 15 seconds before they hang up on us. So Jesus loves you, you know. No, just asking people questions. Most people, they're so desperate for a conversation. We have atheists that thank us because we listen to them. I was at University of Cape Town, and instead of doing a God's Not Dead event, I flipped the script up. We invited atheists. We had an atheist event because on the God test, there's a side A, so we advertised for atheists to come. So I got in there with a room full of atheists at University of Cape Town, and I said, okay, let me explain how this is going to go. I said, I'm going to put some questions up on the screen, and I'm going to go around the room, and I want you to talk to me first. So the atheist side of the God test are, what are the main reasons you don't believe in God? And we found out there's three primary reasons that people don't. They say there's no evidence for God. Evolution says there's no need for him. And then evil and suffering says he's really not there. So we've studied this thousands of times with atheists all over the world, on campuses all over the world. So we know the general, but we still want to hear their answer. So we listen to them. What are the main reasons you don't believe in God? Then we just pass the microphone around and let them talk. No wrong answers. Okay. Then the next question, do you find any ultimate purpose or meaning in the universe? So if there is no God, then is there any real thing called purpose? Because if there is no God, how could there be? If we came into existence for no reason, then how could we'd only just be making up reason, pretending it's here. If it's not ultimately, and especially if we're going to nothing, then how could this little brief interlude between meaningless and nothingness have any meaning ultimately at all? Then how do you account for the laws of nature? Because when people say to you, well, who made God? Okay, great. Okay, let's flip it around. You say the universe came into existence because of the laws of physics. So who made the laws of physics? So both atheist and theist have to have something that they posit that's always been there. Now, what seems more logical? An eternal law like gravity or a lawgiver? Okay, so we ask that. Next question, does evil exist? So if you don't believe in God, is there any such thing as evil? Short answer is, if there is no God, there is no evil. You can't even describe the universe we live in without borrowing biblical terms to make sense of it. What is the basis of your morality? Now, atheists can be good, but that's not because they don't need God. Just like religious people can be bad. Can religious people be bad? Absolutely. Just because I know the speed limit does not mean I'm going to slow down. Just because I believe in the police doesn't mean I'm going to slow down. Just knowing there's a God and knowing what his laws are do not mean that you're going to somehow obey that. That's the mystery of how do I know what's right, but what's wrong with me? See, that's why we need a Savior. Another question. Do you think human life is special compared to plant or animal life? I love asking this question and then kind of a follow-up. Do you think there's any difference between you and a dog besides where your dish is located in the kitchen? Any difference? And it begins to hit people. Now we'll ask these questions, and then after doing this publicly, passing the microphone around at University of Cape Town, then after listening thoroughly, you'd be amazed at how they will give you your turn. I did that publicly, and when it came time for me to talk, no one interrupted me. I was able to say, now I've listened to you and your answers, let me give you the answers to this. That principle works not only in large settings, it works with individuals. If you just listen to them, ask them questions. Tell me your story. Tell me your journey to unbelief. I have a friend that wrote a piece for the Atlantic magazine. You can look it up online, called Listening to Young Atheists. In fact, I was with him. He's building a training center in France in a little city called La Bastide, which you had to go to Toulouse, and then I went down there before I went to Marseille. And sitting with him just this week, and he was recounting that he brought these atheists in to his office and said, just tell me your journey to unbelief. And most of these young atheists would start out, well, you know, it was science. Yeah, it was science. I just, you know, I'm scientific, analytical. Just believe, you know, I'm a science person, you know. Just real intellectual. Okay, good, good, great. So as he listened to their scientific journey, then he would begin to ask questions. Tell me about your family. Tell me about your dad. Tell me about what it was like growing up. And one by one, the brokenness, the disillusionment, the hurt, the pain. Not understanding church, not getting it. And what seemed to be a smokescreen of some intellectual reason was really hiding something much more emotional. I remember going to the gym years ago, and there was a guy that used to walk around all the time, and he about every 2 minutes had to check and make sure his arms hadn't gone anywhere. He was checking how the implants were going. But he always wore sweatpants. And one day he came in, and he didn't have any sweatpants on, and I realized why he'd been wearing them, because his muscles down here didn't match here. In other words, there's something that people don't like to. If they're weak in some area, they want to keep you focused on their strength. And so there's always something within a person that they're hiding, that they're covering up. Not diabolically, but something that they just don't want you picking on or asking questions about. And once they begin to trust you, if you start asking enough questions, then people are going to tell you where their struggle really is. So in Engage, the first step of making disciples, we're praying and we're asking God. And then we're engaging others. Never been a more critical time for this group of people to grow and to learn how to engage others and to not be afraid. In fact, the only way I know you can get good at this is by doing it. The way I got good at it is because I faced more people that I had no answers for, and I had to say, I got to learn that. I'll be right back. My study was predicated upon the challenge I got from unbelievers. We'll start this week. I'll be Tuesday at Drexel University, and then I'll go to UNC, University of North Carolina, Duke, North Carolina Central, University of Maryland, and then Arizona State. There's six campuses, and I can promise you, by the time I get through with these six things this month, when I get done with these speeches, there's going to be some question or some comment or some skeptical deal that I'm gonna be glad that I've got Dr. Brian Miller, my physicist associate, with me. Going, go ahead, Brian, tell that. And yet, when I hear that challenge, what does it make me do? It makes me go back and study. It humbles you, but yet I've learned that there's very few questions that you won't be able to see coming again and again and again. Okay, so we engage. The second step of making a disciple is that we establish. You engage God and man. You establish foundations. And the best thing I can do for simplicity's sake is just hold this little purple book up. Again, we've given out hundreds of thousands of these. There's over, you know, I don't even want to know how many in print. But this book started out as a kind of a divine accident. It was written up called Biblical Foundations. And it was supposed to be in blue. And the printer sent it to me, and it was in this ugly purple. And he said, look, I won't charge you, but please just use it. Don't make me reprint it. So I held up, I said, hey, this ugly purple book, we want you to do it. And it caught on, so now it's a purple book. But what this is, it's a tool that you can use to kind of help establish foundations. It's a shovel. It's a little scoop to kind of dig out. Because if you're going to follow Jesus, Jesus said you have to dig down deep and lay foundations on the rock. We have to, in making disciples, connect them with this word. And if they don't get connected to the word, and they just get connected to an experience of church and a culture of Christianity, then what's going to happen is they're going to have no roots, and the first thing that comes along is going to pull them away, and they're going to get blown away. You can walk through a cornfield, and corn has a little root system about like that. Any little, you know, dainty, delicate woman could pick that up without much effort. I remember years ago, my dad, we had this, when I was a little boy, we had this tree. A hurricane came through, knocked a lot of this tree down, so they had to cut the tree down, but left the stump in the yard. Now, years ago, I thought my dad loved my big brother more than me. Always believed he loved my older brother more than me. One time, my brother did something terrible. I thought my dad was going to kill him. And my dad said to my brother, did you do that? And my big brother said, yes, sir, I did. And I'm just bracing, getting behind him. Blood's going to go everywhere. And my dad stepped up. He said, son, I'm proud of you for telling the truth, and gave him $5. I remember sitting there behind the guys going, $5. One day, there was two rules in my house growing up. Couldn't sass, talk back to your mom, couldn't lie, and you couldn't use my daddy's toothbrush. Three rules. And one day my dad came home, and I think somebody had used his toothbrush, because he'd go to work early in the morning, and he'd come back and at 5 or 5:30, and he went back and he came out holding his toothbrush, and it was wet. He said, did somebody use my toothbrush? Now, I didn't use the toothbrush, but I had a vision. $5. I said, I did. What? You used my toothbrush? He starts spanking me. I said, no, I didn't. Oh, now you're lying. You know? That was the kind of stuff that made me think that he just didn't like me. My brother did something bad after that stump, the tree had been cut down and there was a stump. My dad said to my older brother, you can't leave the house, you can't leave our yard till you dig that stump up. And I started crying because I got punished for digging in the yard, you know, chopping stuff up. My brother's punishment was digging that stump up. I thought he's going to dig that up for 2 days and be banned. He was there for weeks. The more my brother dug down, the more roots seemed to be under the ground than were on top. I had a little stingray bike, banana bars. I'd ride around him, you know, scratching out, you know, kind of figured out after a few weeks, you know, I got you where I want you, right here, you know. But what we want is we want to get roots so deep that no persecution, no affliction. And that's what this is. We've got them here's one in Arabic. That's Spanish. And here's the Arabic one. But what we want you to do, we give these tools to you. I don't make any money on this. Whatever comes here is just, this is not an infomercial. It's you learning to use this tool to what? To establish. So you engage law. You engage by engaging God, and then then others with you know, starting conversations and whatnot. You establish foundations, and then you equip. And really equip. There's no greater way to equip people in this discipleship process of engage, establish foundations, equip, and empower. The engage or the equip. I think there's no greater mechanism that God has given us than these life groups. Life groups are not some gimmick, again, to kind of get you to another event that keeps you from doing what you want to do in your personal life. You will eventually need a small group of people around you, I promise you. After 35 years of being a pastor and a minister, that small group of people around me is still the lifeblood of me being sustained. Being able to have people that aren't just, you know, oh, you're Pastor Rice, you don't need, are you kidding me? I need your help. I need your prayers. There's times in which I have to just have people, and I do have these people, that they're not impressed with me. They don't care about how much I preach. The devil sure not. So, and you can carry around something trying to pretend and be somebody, Captain Charismatic, whatever you are. And let me tell you can sit there and hold on and try to keep secret what's going on in your life. But eventually, now what eventually you'll do is you'll go pay someone to listen to you. Because that's the pride of, well, I don't want to tell somebody something that's, you know, that I wouldn't want to, you know, I don't want the church knowing my problems. That's, whenever I hear that thing, I go, oh, okay, now you've really been bitten by something that's wrong. Where else can you go? Having people around you. And that small group of people. I think this would be safe to say that your destiny, I could figure it out by just looking and seeing the circle of people you're around. Now what most people do is they surround themselves with people that aren't following Jesus, claiming that they're ministering to them. Well, I'm, you know, being a lot. No, I promise what's going to happen. That small group and their values are going to win you. And you're going to eventually go in the direction of the people that you're walking with. On the other hand, you find somebody, if you really want to serve God, get around somebody that knows God at least as much or maybe better than you do. Find them. They're all over the place. And it's not just the one that talks hyper-religious talk, but it's the person that you can see. You can see it in their eyes. You can hear it in their voice. I remember sitting in income tax class. I was an accounting major at Mississippi State, and I remember just coming to Christ and listening to the guy behind me who was the top accounting student in our school. And when the teacher walked out on the break, this guy behind me started talking about what God was doing on campus. And I turned around in income tax class and I just said, "What are you talking about?" And it wasn't long that I found myself in a restaurant with him, and then in walked Steve Merle, who was 2 years younger than me, but Steve walks in. And I found myself around a group of people that had a destiny and they were going somewhere. You're going to get a chance in the coming days to not just be one, but to join one, to get around some people. Don't take that as an option. Don't think that that's somehow some little luxury item. No thanks, I'll pass on that. Put the life group on the side. Don't have time for it. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for the urgency of the hour. Lord, urgency creates action, creates a sense of change. Lord, we have to feel the pressure to change. Lord, I pray that no one here will somehow act as if this is some kind of theoretical religion or theoretical Christianity that won't meet them where they are. Lord, as we learn to pray and engage with you, not only do other people get changed, but Lord, our hearts are changed because we turn from our self-absorption, our self-centeredness. We turn and begin to look out beyond the world.